At first glance, the universe seems immutable. Other than the odd comet passing through, meteor shower, or supernova, the night sky doesn't change much over short time scales. But in a way, that's really a matter of resolution. Usually you don't see much change with the heavens with the naked eye that isn't expected to happen. It sometimes does. Who could forget the great Betelgeuse dimming event of recent years? But again, looking at the sky at low resolution isn't going to yield much change. A telescope, however, changes that to a degree. You can see comets occasionally hit Jupiter, for example, as happened in the 90s, that left black marks on the face of Jupiter that even small telescopes could spot. And you can watch variable stars change in brightness and many other things. But again, we know why those things happen, and they really are mundane changes in our present understanding of astronomy. But with increasing resolution comes new mysteries where things can sometimes disappear, and we have absolutely no idea why. Sometimes, even years later, these instances continue to defy explanation, or have outright fallen into obscurity. One such case is a young star known as TYC-8241-2652. This star is basically an analog of the Sun, interestingly, a type G at the earliest stages of its life, located in the constellation Centaurus. It is about 10 million years old. Compare that to the Sun's 4.6 billion year age, and is about 450 light years distant. It was first observed in 1983 by the IRAS satellite. IRAS, a collaboration between the US, Netherlands, and UK, was an all-sky infrared survey space telescope, a very early one, that saw the star in question glowing brightly in infrared. This was perfectly normal. Young stars like this often have debris disks of dust and gas, which would normally condense into planets. The Sun did this. It had such a disk that slowly coalesced into the solar system's worlds and asteroids and such. But such disks normally should take very long periods, geologic time, to complete that process. During that process, the star heats the dust and gas up, and we see that warmth of it radiating into space as infrared. TYC-8241-2652 appeared to be doing that for 25 years, just an unchanging debris disk when it was looked at periodically. And then, it very rapidly disappeared. In 2010, NASA's WISE spacecraft took another look at the star, and the disk was missing in certain wavelengths of infrared. This should not be. The universe doesn't usually work on very short timescales like that in the case of a debris disk. This happened over just a few years. So what exactly happened to cause this giant star system's entire debris disk to disappear, or at least drastically change so fast? There were a handful of hypotheses, and none of them were very good. One was that a huge impact on a forming planet might have caused the dust to fall into the star very quickly, but that seemed implausible. Another was that the dust was colliding for some reason and crushing into smaller, undetectable particles. This would be smaller than particles of smoke, and that too didn't seem plausible to occur that rapidly. And it has to be said, a very rapidly harvesting von Neumann probe, or more probably a swarm of them, might do this. But even then, that's awfully fast, even for such a speculative idea. One thing to note here is that protoplanetary disks have more than just planet formation going on, they also have collisions. Think a huge population of asteroids and protoplanets all smashing into each other as the debris disk clears. But this takes millions of years, and also serves to repopulate a system with dust. This did not seem to happen normally with TYC-8241-2652. Whatever happened in that star system remains a mystery. Another more recent example of a disappearance involved the star HD 139-139, which was observed as part of the Kepler mission. Kepler was a photometer, watching light curves of stars for tiny dips as exoplanets passed in front of the star. It discovered numerous new exoplanets, and remains one of the most successful such searches to date. Its successor, TESS, is also yielding many new finds, often much closer than those found by Kepler. HD 139-139 is a binary star system consisting of another sun analog, a type G, slightly larger than the sun but the same temperature, that has a red dwarf companion star in the system. During the Kepler run, this star, which could have been either member of the system dimming like this, saw 28 dips that appeared to be exoplanets. All of the dips revealed planets of very similar size except one, which was double the size of the others. The mystery here was that the dips did not show any periodicity, meaning it's unlikely that they were in orbit of one or both of the stars. Fast forward to this year. This star was looked at again recently, and lo and behold, they saw no dips at all. Whatever caused those dips has disappeared, and is no longer occluding the stars of that system. There are a number of things that could do this. One is that the Kepler instrument glitched, but it does not seem likely because it never did anything like this again, and the detections outside of a lack of periodicity look like exoplanets. Another option is that the objects were foreground objects, passing in front of the star. One could imagine a group of rogue planets moving through the interstellar medium and appearing to pass in front of the star from our perspective, when in fact they were not located near that star system at all. There actually is a known incidence of this kind of thing having been observed. This one in itself is a weird case because these planets were not in our galaxy. Seeing planets in other galaxies is extremely difficult due to the immense distances involved, but there are candidates for it. But the further you look, the less likely it is to see exoplanet transits, unless very special circumstances are present. One such case was the Quasar RX J1131-1231. This quasar is a whopping 6 billion light years away, and is very rare in that it is severely gravitationally lensed by a foreground galaxy that actually has formed a quadruple image of the quasar, and actually delays some of the images gravitationally, so that it actually causes a time delay. One image of the quasar is seen before the others. Another oddity about this quasar is that it has a supermassive black hole located in it that is, again, rather rare. In 2014, astronomers detected an X-ray source in the quasar that was being emitted by the accretion disk of a black hole. The problem is that the accretion disk was very tightly packed in, only about 3 times the radius of the black hole's event horizon. The only way that can happen is if the black hole is spinning extremely rapidly for the disk to exist. That allowed astronomers to make a very rare measurement of the rotation speed of a black hole, and it's frankly shocking. This black hole is rotating at nearly 1/2 of the speed of light. The only way for that to occur is if that the black hole is being fed by an unbelievably vast amount of gas and dust. But back to the planets. Astrophysicists from the University of Oklahoma were able to take advantage of the gravitational lensing of this quasar to detect an apparent group of rogue planets in this quasar, ranging from the size of the Moon to the size of Jupiter, moving through the interstellar medium of that quasar. So rogue planets can move in front of stars, and maybe Kepler just happened to be looking at exactly the right time to catch a group of them moving in front of the HD 139/139 system. We may never know. Perhaps the strangest case of astronomical disappearances are the VASCO detections. VASCO stands for Vanishing and Appearing Sources During a Century of Observations. And they look for transients, things that happen suddenly on short timescales in astronomy, by looking at archived photographic plate surveys of the sky, and comparing different years to see if anything has appeared or disappeared. They have numerous candidates for stars just up and disappearing, about 100. This is weird because stars really don't have many ways to vanish. They can explode as supernovae, and they can dim as Betelgeuse did, but fundamentally they shouldn't just go away. Except there may be a mechanism. There is a hypothesis that a giant star can directly collapse into a black hole without a supernova, which would make it appear to simply vanish. The problem is that those specific circumstances that allow for it should be exceedingly rare. We should not see this 100 times a century, rather more like 1 every few 100 million years or more. There's also gravitational lensing on the table, where the star's light was actually magnified by a lensing source, perhaps a black hole in the interstellar medium, that might allow for a star to be seen until it passes, and the star's apparent brightness dims below detection. Asteroids can also move in front of stars, making them temporarily seem to disappear, that would be more common. But there is another option. If an alien civilization were to construct a Dyson sphere around a star, recent calculations by David Kipping show that it actually is possible to do it, just only under very specific conditions, such as the sphere being extremely thin. There doesn't really seem to be much of a motivation to do that for aliens. But that aside, it might, if it could be constructed and deployed very rapidly, cause a star to disappear in visible light, but not infrared. Alternatively, a very dense Dyson swarm might block a star's light enough to drop it below detectability, which is a far easier thing to do physically. It would also be very odd indeed to see a clustering of these transients. If a bunch of stars are disappearing from one single area of the sky, that would be a tick in the box for some sort of activity by an alien civilization. And it has to be said, we only know what we've thought of in speculative science and science fiction. There may be technologies that can dim or block starlight that aliens might employ that we simply haven't conceived of. A way to look at this is our technology. Someone in 1865, not that long ago, would have known that balloons can fly. And some in those days thought, actually stretching far before that year, that if birds can fly, then we should be able to build a machine that can do the same thing. Though there were some that also said that it would be forever impossible. What they could not have envisioned was that in less than a century, the airline industry would be flying many thousands of people per day in aircraft going all over the planet every day of the year. They just had no way to conceive that such a thing could be possible before someone cracked powered flight. Who knows what the aliens do? Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently deeply concerned that someone out there is stealing our astronomical objects. Actually, the universe is like that. The Milky Way over its history has absorbed, or stolen, a number of dwarf galaxies. But after billions and billions of years of unhinged kleptomania, the Milky Way itself will be stolen by none other than the significantly larger Andromeda Galaxy. We just can't have nice things in this universe, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.